before they're doing the lip sync battle. And so that's probably going to be filtering in. Please tell me if you can't hear me. I think this is pretty good. I can project myself if necessary, but hopefully this is good enough for you guys. So my name is Valerie, and this is Academic Anime Crash Course, now with extra Pokemon. Yay! I'm assuming most of you people are Pokemon fans, and that's probably why you're here. I like the fact that the Jedi and the Sith are nodding their heads. Yes. That's awesome. That makes me feel happy. So my name is Valerie. I have been studying film for about 12 years. I have 3 degrees in it, mostly in film theory. And while I was studying it, I actually took a course on anime. It was the first one that's ever been offered in the country. This was like 2005. That helps you figure out how old I am. I'm kind of old. I'm in my 30s. But it was really cool and interesting because I never thought about anime in a scholastic setting. And once I went through this course, that kind of changed my perspective on what I wanted to study, where I wanted to go with my career. And ever since then, I've been devoting myself to anime and video game studies, the digital narrative, and how that's impacting films in the West. So that's how this panel came about. I taught it once before in 2011, and since then, I've been really wanting to return and bring it back in. And because anime has this lovely thing called fans, I was able to do this, and that's so awesome. Really? Really? Okay. I'll go with it. So yeah, hopefully you guys enjoy this panel. My hope and my goal, cute, right? My goal with this panel is I hope that you guys end up learning something. And you can go home to your mom, your dad, your grandparents, your teacher, your boss, and say, this is why anime can be used in the school. And you can go like, okay, you can watch One Piece for another 30 minutes. Or maybe I can get you to laugh a little bit with some of the silly pictures that I've got coming up. Some of the things that we'll be going over with, we'll go over a brief history of anime, and then we're going to go over anime and Japan's cultural identity. We're going to go into what is anime from an academic standpoint, how to view anime academically, so we're going to go into a lot of film theory terms. And then we'll have Pokemon, which I argue is the prime example of the best anime out there from an academic standpoint. Sound good? So this is going to be more of a lecture style type of panel, but if you have any questions or if you want to interject your opinion at any point, please raise your hand because I love audience participation. I don't want to feel like I'm only just talking at you, okay? All right. So, first thing we're going to go over is the brief history of anime. So, film was initially introduced in 1897. Oh, wait, hang on. Let me rephrase that. I'm getting distracted by Madonna, because I'm like such an 80s head too, if it's not obvious. I love my 80s, so Madonna's distracting me. So film was initially introduced in Japan in 1896. It was the first camera, the kinetoscope, was made in America in 1895 by Thomas Edison. There we go, that's where I was going with. And then the actual first film was produced in 1897. So literally within a year of seeing film, it was already out and available in Japan.
And the first...
Hello. Something happened with the mic, sorry. Okay, so from there, the first public showing of an animation was in 1917. It was called Namakura Katana. It was a 2-minute clip of a samurai who got a sword for the first time and was testing it out on his enemy, and he failed. And it's interesting is the art style on it is very reminiscent of Walt Disney, who did not even exist at that time. It was just the way the animation was drawn is very much like Steamboat Willie. Do you guys know what Steamboat Willie is? I see a lot of head nodding, so that's a good thing. Yay. You kids know, I don't feel so old. So by the 1930s, animation was considered a stable rival to film because at that point, it became heavily ingrained in their entertainment. Walt Disney was very much involved and influenced in this. Their first movie, Snow White, a lot of Japanese animators at the time felt like that was the pinnacle of filmmaking. And so they tried their best to mimic it as much as they possibly could. One of the reasons that anime took hold so easily, and scholars believe, is because of manga. Now, manga is something that could possibly be traced back to the 18th century, so many, many centuries ago. And a lot of it came out of picture books or woodblock drawings, just people trying to make recreations of what they've seen. And then over time, that kind of evolved into flip books. Now, manga as we know it today didn't really develop until the 1950s, when comic books became really big in America. So before then, though, a lot of picture books were in homes, they were in government offices. So, I mean, people were revolving their lives around animation in some form or another, just maybe not the way that we see it today. So for the Japanese, it was much easier for them to incorporate animation into an everyday thing, whereas for us in America, we still unfortunately see it as something for kids. Now, those of us in this room know that anime is not just for kids. We know it's not just for kids. There are things in the 18 plus panels that prove to us that it's not just for kids. However, we are unfortunately a minority in that opinion here in the West. Most people still see anime as just animation. It's Cartoon Network, it's the Disney Channel, it's DreamWorks. I mean, and slowly and steadily it's changing in the academic world. We just gotta take it one step at a time. All right, so now we're going to anime and Japan's cultural identity. By the way, that was a very short and brief history, because if I had the time to, we'd probably be here all night. Lots of cool stuff happens in the history of anime, so I strongly recommend that you guys take the chance to Google it, look it up. Actually, Wikipedia, for all of its faults, is a really good resource on the history of anime, so fair warning. So I talked a little bit about how we view animation here in the West. We know that anime is very, very important in the East. Let's see, where do we want to start with? Okay, so some film scholars believe that anime's popularity in Japan has to do with their participation in the global culture. By the 1990s, it became more apparent that not only did the West influence anime, but anime was influencing Western media as well. Probably the most prime example is Kimba the White Lion, who is very much reminiscent of Simba from The Lion King. Disney, while they don't outright say it, does borrow some ideas and concepts from anime. You wonder why they have such a good relationship with Studio Ghibli, or Ghibli, however you wish to say it. They respect anime. They see where anime has been and where it is going, and they want animation to do the same thing. The director of the Toy Story movies, John Lasseter, I think he's VP of Disney, or he's one of the higher echelons of Disney now. He really, really appreciates Miyazaki's work and actually looked to them as reference when he created Toy Story. Yes?
So Kimba came out before The Lion King?
Way before. This is like 1950s. Yeah. That's why I picked this particular image. I was like, if you make him yellow, he's Simba. I was really, really trying to find an appropriate photo of like Simba standing on a rock, but the only ones I got were really bad gifts of the monkey holding him up and then some bad things happening to Simba at that point, like Simba drops down the cliff. I was like, I'm not putting that in my presentation, that's so terrible, no. But it kind of goes the same way too, because the West has also been influencing Japan since the very, very beginning of animation and film. So there's this effect called de-Japanizing, which basically means trying to make the characters look more universally appealing. So the situations and the locations they're in may look like they're in Japan, like you got bathhouses, you got their schools, you've got their temples, but the things they're wearing don't always scream they're from Japan, or their skin tone, or their hair color, other than their eyes looking really big and freaky, there's nothing that really screams that this person is Japanese. And a lot of that is to include the world in their influence. Okay, so now we go to what exactly is anime? And I think this is a really difficult thing to define, because we can just easily say that it's just animation from Japan. But I think it goes well beyond that, because there's so many branches and aspects of anime that a simple definition is just not enough for it. Right now, currently, anime is considered a subhead of animation in film theory. And animation is currently split up by like the method of filming. So you've got like claymation, you got hand-drawn, you got computer. And that's kind of sad, because anime is more than just hand-drawn animation from Japan. It's all these different things. It's all these different aspects to it. Like, you can have one anime that has romantic comedy and action and drama and sci-fi and slapstick and all of this stuff, but that's just in one anime. You can't really define it. It boggles my mind when people say that Evangelion is just a mecha. It's not. Like, one of my favorite episodes is this dancing one, where Asuka and Shinji have to coordinate their movements with their Evangelions in order to defeat one of the angels. And it is just nothing but 30 minutes of silliness. There isn't really no blood in this episode, and then 5 episodes later we're decapitating people. So, I mean, to me it just seems like we're doing it a disservice by just saying anime is simply hand-drawn animation from Japan, because there's so much more to it. So how are we going to define anime when the film community is still not too sure what to do with it? And I think the best way of doing that is to break outside of our normal barriers and look at it from an academic standpoint. As such, that's why this panel is here. Water break. Music's not that bad though, right? They had some good 80s going on earlier too, so it was very distracting. Okay, so now I'm going to go into some of the different branches of anime and how one would probably look at it from a scholastic point of view. Since we're still kind of defining this amongst scholars and academics, it's very easy for us to change our minds and opinions, because there are some people who get really in-depth and will be like, no, this is what that is. So I'll say that some of this is personal opinion as well as pulling in from multiple sources. So, and that's the cool thing about this field, is that right now we're kind of just starting out into getting the academics of anime. You could go a million different ways with this. I mean, I've seen people write papers on like how the movie Mean Girls can tie in so well with Chobits. Seriously, like, I've written papers on South Park before, so. But that's what's so cool about it, is that you can look at anime in so many different directions and just take it wherever you want it to go. As long as you can prove your points, then you're good. So my first big thing is, I don't think animes have genres, because I think that's doing a big disservice to them, as I said earlier with Evangelion. I think that they should be called branches. So you have your main branch, which is basically, here is the main plot point, or you know, this is going to be a romantic comedy. But then you have other branches that kind of sprout out on top of it. So it's a romantic comedy, and they have a bit of drama, and maybe there's some mecha, maybe there's some sci-fi, and they all kind of intertwine with each other like a branch would, or like leaves would. So I think that makes way more sense than trying to just stick everything into one genre. Because I know Chobits is not just romantic comedy. It's not just shoujo. It's so much more than that. And I think that's probably the best way to go about it. So the first branch I want to cover is the magical girl, which is the shoujo drama. Now, what I think is really interesting about shoujo is that it initially started as kind of a marketing campaign to try to get girls more interested into anime. It actually didn't turn into its own subsect of like, this is what it's about, until later on. And the other cool thing that I think is really interesting and unique about shoujo is the fact that almost always it's going to be a full cast of girls or women leading the charge. Japan is like the only freaking country that does this. As a feminist, that makes me really happy. If you look at it from like the stuff that we produce here in the States, it's very rare that we get female leads unless it's like a romantic comedy. And that's maybe about it. You could argue things like, well, you know, the Avengers has Black Widow, now they have Scarlet Witch. But by comparison to their male counterparts, they have the least amount of screen time, they have even lesser merchandising, and so on and so forth. But with shoujo, it's not just about romantic comedies. You got action, you got drama, you got science fiction, you got girls in robot suits, like in Bubblegum Crisis. So it kind of goes all over the board. And that's something that's really unique to Japan. And I think that's what makes shoujo so cool. It's also very adorable. Sickeningly adorable. You watch it because it's pretty. Next one I want to talk about is the apocalyptic identity, otherwise known as dystopian or eulogy. And a lot of this has to do with the future in a post-war, post-disaster era. Now, what's interesting about this is, in Japan, they don't really glamorize like an end-of-the-world scenario. They talk about what happens after the world ends. And Evangelion, again, I think it's the best anime ever, is like a fantastic example of that. They don't really focus on the events or show you what happens. They talk about what happens afterwards. Let's rebuild society after the first impact. Whereas here in the West, we love to show off all the gory bits as much as possible. Oh my goodness. Like, we have the San Andreas movie coming out this weekend. I think it's this weekend. Yeah. Blowing stuff up is something we love to do.
During World War II, for West, the war ended whenever we won, that Japan and the U.S. won. But for them, they lost whenever post-apocalyptic stuff happened. And so that was one of the key interests, saying that that's the reason they don't glamorize it, because they've lost because of it.
Yeah, definitely. And a lot of it also has to do with religion. Because here in the West, we're predominantly Christian related. So for us, it's like an end of time, you know, when is Jesus going to have his second coming? So we focus on that. Whereas in Buddhism, Taoism, Shintoism, it's more about focusing on the human and the community. There really isn't an end all, this is where life is going to end. It's about bettering yourself for mankind. Yes?
So much that they lost, so much as the devastating effects that they had to suffer for years afterwards.
Definitely.
Even the decade after the war had since ended. And you can definitely see that in quite a few works, such as like Grave of the Fireflies, which is a biography. Actually, it's a biography, so that might not count because that's one personal man's story. But
sure.
Jinro, specifically, I think, is a very good example of why
Jinro made you cry like a little baby, such as Grave of the Fireflies.
Which
oh my
is basically
goodness.
Why Japan will tear apart and deconstruct this idea of war, because it remembers the nuclear fallout and still has issues with that. So
absolutely.
That's going to affect their perspective on things quite a bit compared to us. We've never suffered those effects on a large scale.
Definitely. Japan definitely has a very unique perspective because they lived not just through one, but two atomic bombs. So for them, they experienced disaster completely differently from the way that we have before. And I think a lot of it helps attribute to their post-war stories, and they focus on the victim and what happens afterwards, not so much on the event itself. It's very rare that you'll get a couple where they actually show the atomic bombings. The few that do are pretty gruesome, and I know they're just like, you can't sit through them, like, barefoot again. Oh, be brave. That one I'm not a big fan of. No. Really?
Good segue.
Really? I'm this is okay. No. I'm really trying to ignore it, but man. If a friend of mine was here, I would totally break out and say this. I'm a 90s kid, what can I say? The other thing I want to point out about the apocalyptic identity is that these type of stories tend to get really, really popular in times of turmoil or whenever there's any type of social change in Japan. So this is something we want to keep in mind. I'll be bringing that back up later. Okay, next one is metamorphosis or a body identity. You're changing either your physical or your mental self. Again, another big theme in Japan. A lot of this you'll see in like mecha or shoujo animes, mechas in particular, because you're watching the transition of children into becoming adults by getting in giant robots and destroying things. It makes perfect sense to me. Okay, so now we've gone over some of the branches. I want to jump into some film theory terms because, as I said before, the West has really influenced Japan in how they came up with cinema, so I think it's only fair that we bring in some of our terms to help express what's going on in the academics of the anime. So the first one I want to jump into is the auteur theory. And it's this idea that the director's creative personal vision is reflected in the film more so than the storyboard and the scriptwriter. Basically, he's taking over the film and the film is now his and his alone, or hers and hers alone. And it typically transcends over multiple projects. So like with Steven Spielberg, he's a fantastic example of this. I like to say that he has daddy issues. Even though he came from a really stable home, he doesn't like to have dads in his movies. He likes to do single parents because he thinks that that helps the characters have greater strife and they're more willing to overcome their differences because they only have a single family home. So that's just such an example. In Japan, it tends to be more like studio-wide. So like, you know when you're watching a guy next TV show. It is very obvious when you're watching a guy next TV show. Just as with Studio Ghibli, you know when you're watching a Ghibli film. You can't tell me you don't know when you're watching one, because it's obvious when they do. And the next one I want to jump into is a relatively new term to the field. It's called hyperlink cinema. This was actually coined by somebody else, but Roger Ebert used it frequently in 2005 to talk about a movie, Syria. And it's essentially the movie having so many multiple plot lines that they come together in the end, and the journey of those plot lines syncing up is what the audience experiences. So, Siri was the movie that I suggested, but I think in terms of anime, Dragon Ball is probably a fantastic example. And I think for anime, they've been doing this for decades. We just didn't have a term for it until recently, because hyperlink is something very internet savvy, of course. I mean, hyperlinks, you go online, lots of blue things to click, click the blue things, done. But with Dragon Ball, when you think about it, it's ridiculously got like, what, 20 plot lines at one time, and you have to follow all of them? Like, what, right now, Toonami has the Cell Saga, no, the Frieza Saga going on, I believe. So you have Goku going to Namek to try to stop Frieza, then you have Vegeta's story on Namek because he's trying to find the Dragon Balls, and then, let's see, we got Krillin and Gohan on Namek trying to find the Dragon Balls, and then Bulma's on Namek trying to find the Dragon Balls. And then I know there's a couple of guys sitting up in heaven training to go to Namek to find the Dragon Balls. And there's like five other sub-stories on top of that, and there's like another sub-story in the sub-story. Yeah. You see where I'm going, right? Makes sense, right? But you see this in anime all the time, and it's interesting to me how this isn't common in Western. This is like strictly an Asian-Japanese thing. Okay, next one is Man versus Nature. And this has been a very, very common storytelling theme for pretty much all of Japanese history that we have known or found about them. Nature is a very, very common thing in Japan. It's about respecting nature, about adoring it, not necessarily worshiping it, but working in conjunction with it. As we grow as people, we need to also protect nature because that's what gave us life, that type of mindset. And a lot of that is like Buddhism, Shintoism teachings. And a lot of this is common storytelling that we've seen as early as the Heian period, which I gave up there. So long, long time. Then you'll see it in like fables. I know we've got fables like that too, but in Japan they tend to take them a little bit more seriously. And all things Ghibli, all things Miyazaki, is definitely about stories of man versus nature. Cannot deny that. You need proof? Watch Princess Mononoke. A lot. The next one I want to talk about is Japan versus the world. And many stories in Japanese entertainment focus on an us versus them mentality. For all that anime tries to do in making it de-Japanizing and making the characters more Western, a lot of their plot lines and a lot of the scenarios that happen are strictly Japan. They're only going to happen here. They're not going to happen anywhere else. Like, my favorite video game, well, one of my favorites is the Ace Attorney series. I love how they, when they modern, like, got it over here in the West, it's like, no, this is taking place in America. Why is there a Buddhist shrine? Where did that thing come from? Yeah, so.
Can I make a side comment? All I'm wondering is, what are they going to do for the fifth game that takes place in the early Japanese period?
I have no idea, but look, she was asking, what are they going to do in the fifth game? Because the sixth game, yeah, with it takes place in, like, early Japan. Yeah. It's old New York. That's what it is. So some scholars believe this has always been a constant in Japanese entertainment, and it's an offshoot of isolationism that the country has experienced for many centuries, especially like post-World War II, post-atomic bombing. They really try to, you know, come in on themselves and like, no more outsiders, we don't want anything here. And they have periods of that every now and then. And you look at Japan, Japan is a pretty decent-sized island, but look what it's surrounded by. Nothing but ocean, and then you have China on the other side. It is easy to stand alone and to feel like you're this little tadpole in a giant arse pond. Yes?
Plus, you have to look at the points of time before you got to technically it's not kind of coordination.
That too. So you have all these things that are influencing it, that nationalism actually becomes a big theme in anime. You may not see it directly. It tends to be pretty subversive. There we go. Okay, so now we're gonna go to the next fun part.
It's
is Pokemon the greatest anime of all time. I'm gonna argue that it is. This is also where I want to thank Mike, because if you look in the guidebook, the one that says animal abuse and the lovely ball hitting Pikachu in the face is actually my guidebook image. So thanks, thanks, Akon. So I'm going to start off with the full knowledge that I realize Pokemon did not start out as an anime. I'm 100% aware of this because I grew up at a time when Pokemon was originally released. So I have my Game Boy still. I still have the original blue and red. I even have the yellow. I got the special edition Game Boy and all that fun stuff. I didn't play the card game. My brother did. So I get it that it didn't start out as an anime. However, I do think that in it being developed as an anime, it really transcended and managed to capture a lot of the key points that we see in Japanese culture and what makes it so academically appropriate. So I start out that. There's my warning. I try to keep up with the newer games. It's man. I knew all 150 for a while.
How many do you know? Like 700?
Wait.
I forgot the number.
723.
I think it's
794.
737. How are you supposed
to remember all that? With my imagery.
I keep up with
the
Pokemon.
Good point, Pokedex. I used to know like 150, like actually in order, and I was like, wow, this is great. And then they started adding more. Forget that. Okay, so the first thing I'm going to cover is metamorphosis. Now, as we all know, in the anime, you start out following Ash and his wonderful journey into manhood as he becomes the greatest Pokemon master of all time. And he's still 10 years old. How many seasons are we in and the kid has not grown? It's kind of like it's the Simpsons. The Simpsons are 25 freaking years old and they're still, oh my goodness. Bart's still 10. They had 25 Christmases and Halloween specials, you know, that's fine. But that's Ash's journey. And I think what's really cool is that while he may not age in the anime, and nobody ages in the anime, the fact that you could actually feel his transformation, you could see him actually growing, not physically, but mentally, in the way that he is personally changing, how his Pokemon are changing, even the way that he's managed to make Pikachu, because when Pikachu initially comes into the series, he's just a giant brat. Nobody liked him at all, but as he was out and about, and then Ash became a better, stronger trainer, so did Pikachu. There you go. And I think it's also cool to actually watch the Pokemon not only physically transform into higher sections of themselves, but to also mentally like transform. So you see them like working in hospitals and in like the police offices and stuff. So they're actually citizens of the society around them, and that's kind of nifty. All right, so man versus nature, which should be fairly obvious by the photos that I have up here, because notice how awesomely lush everything is. One of the things that I remember about the very early Pokemon was cities didn't really exist. They were just towns. And they didn't have a whole lot of technology. I think that their technological resources all went into how a Pokeball works. Because by logic, you can't get a Charizard in there as far as I'm concerned. So, but I mean, aside from that, I mean, they didn't have a whole lot of like mechanical things. Like there were a couple computers, but not like a whole lot of buses. I mean, they're walking everywhere. Makes you really fit, I must say.
They can fly.
Yeah, they can fly, and they got that option too. But I mean, there is a whole lot of technology, and they really respect nature around them, which I think makes it uber cool. It was cool. What I also like to see is that the bad guys tend to get punished if they try to do anything to disrupt nature. And I think that's why you see Team Rocket always kind of getting like the cold shoulder and stuff like that. So like when Jesse and James come in and try to steal Pikachu every freaking week, it's whenever they try, they get pushed back. Because it's almost like Pikachu is representing another section of nature in itself. You're trying to harm nature, so we're going to stop you. And you're the bad guy, so you go that way. Yeah?
I was gonna say, there's also like the different teams and different generations that represent nature, like mm-hmm. especially Magma and Aqua, and to a degree. Flare?
Yeah.
But Flare is just...
Flare is
there. We're going to protect you by destroying you. Okay. Thanks.
Well, Flare, fire.
Like, love you too.
Actually,
that's
very
interesting.
It's fire. Fire does what it needs to do.
Like a wildfire, maybe.
And then you have Japan versus the world. So, Here's how this whole nationalization thing works here. So after starting on essentially a David and Goliath journey, the very first episode, he wakes up late when he's about to start getting, you know, when he's about to be a trainer. He has to get the least desirable Pokemon out of all the options out there. The Pikachu does not want to stay in his ball. He wants to be a jerk and zap him every chance he can. He sits on his shoulder. He doesn't want to listen. Everybody picks on him for being so short. I mean, this kid has nothing going for him, but he still pushes forward. He still says, no, I'm going to go out there and I'm still going to do this thing. And what a cool thing to tell the little kids of Japan that, hey, if you're small too, you keep your mind to it, you can grow up to be just like Ash. And wouldn't that be awesome to have more Ashes in Japan where you can help our country? Isn't that great? If you can't read the bottom, it says, and destroy the capitalistic American government.
Well, sorry for making like another comment.
No, it's fine, it's fine.
But the Japan versus Worldly also fits into another one, the evil teams, Plasma specifically.
I was about to get into that, yeah.
Because it ends basically all about revolutionizing the world, changing everything so that it fits a more, a better ideal. But he's constantly being thwarted and protested against by the protagonist, and eventually he has to come to a middle ground to try and join the two worlds together rather than a complete overhaul, which
exactly.
is very interesting. I love, you know, but please play back in white.
So yeah, I was actually about to get into that, so you beat me. Cool.
Yay,
see? Academic anime, the Pokemon. You can tell your parents you've learned something at A-Kon this weekend, and be like, I can come back next year, right? And then, aside from that, we have the de-Japanizing of it, you know, large eyes. I know, I'm going to go over to the next slide, because I think the next slide is more appropriate. There we go. And poor Pikachu. But seriously, though, when you look at it from the first season, Pikachu really was kind of a jerk.
He was choking on the apple in that scene.
And Ash cared enough to get it out of him. But, you know, Pikachu was a jerk. So, now we're going to de-Japanizing. And aside from the large anime eyes, with the exception of Brock, who's a special snowflake, does anyone in Pokemon really dress like they're from Japan? There's maybe, like, two or three.
The Kimono Sisters.
Yeah, the Kimono Sisters.
And
Erica. Erica's a good one, too.
After they don't do that anymore. Any more Japanese focus.
Based off New York, Kalos is based off France.
Yeah, but even still, I mean, like the towns that they visit, there's nothing there that screams to me that says, this is Japan. So they take it to a completely different level.
They have the, like the Tin Towers in the same city that the Kimono Girls are
so from.
I think that's like the most Japanese city.
It's like that's the only option and that's it. It's just weird. I mean, other than the fact that they're roaming in forests all the time, which is very much, you know, man versus nature, you don't really, I mean, this doesn't scream Japan to me.
There are shrines for Celebi in the forest.
There are a couple. Or you get lost and you find something. Okay, hyperlink cinema. Now, this one isn't as dramatic as Dragon Ball Z, but I do think that Pokemon does have a lot of sub-stories going on, so obviously you've got Ash going on his journey to become the best Pokemon master and catch them all, woohoo! But then you have things like Team Rocket, not just with Jesse and James and Meowth, but you have their entire subplot with Giovanni and everything that's going on in their central headquarters. You have Brock's infatuation with Nurse Joy and Nurse Jenny, or the whole thing about how Nurse Joy and Nurse Jenny is in every freaking city, and somehow they're all related, and they all look the same. Or, you know, you have the mentor relationship between Ash and Professor Oak that's not creepy in any way, shape, or form. And then you have the goals of every one of Ash's companions as they cycle through. So, I mean, there's a lot of little things going on aside from this is what Ash is doing, this is what Pikachu is doing. Here's the entire stuff of Pokemon. Okay, Pokemon continues. Yay! Shoujo. Aren't they adorable? I love the fact that this is shoujo and shonen, the fact that both men and women love Pokemon. Because there's something to love about it. How can you not love it? Now, I don't think it was their intent to try and capture a female audience with this. I think it was for them to try to get as much people interested as possible, so both boys and girls. I don't know if it was their intent to make it adorable, but maybe it was. Maybe I'm just being naive and giving them too much credit.
Well, the fairy type was introduced.
Yeah.
All these cute Pokemon that can kill dragons.
Yeah, now they do it. These little things that like to beat up the giant dragons. Sure, but back then when they initially started, I think it was kind of like, you know, I want to play innocent. I want to be naive and believe that my Pokemon is pure or true, but it's probably not. I'm sure that these were all created specifically so they could get as much money from kids' parents as possible. If you've played the card game, you know it's true.
I just collected them.
Yeah, but see how adorable they are? If that's not shoujo, I don't know what is. Okay, so now I'm going to have fun and screw with your brains a little bit. I'm going to go with the apocalyptic identity. Okay, it's not that bad, I promise. Okay, so I have seen some fan theories out there that revolve around the Pokemon world being a post-apocalyptic world. Maybe Japan, maybe somewhere else, but like something really bad happened and that helped make the monsters come to life. And strangely enough, I kind of want to agree with them, but I have a reason for this. So in 1995, when the game was initially introduced, Japan was actually undergoing a pretty big turmoil socially, politically, economically. From a physical standpoint, they actually had an earthquake that happened, the Kobe earthquake. Killed 105,000 people. Pretty freaking devastating. They also had a tsunami that year that wiped out a good chunk of their fishing industry. Pretty freaking important. They had a brand new prime minister. He was the first socialist prime minister that Japan ever had in 50 years. And a lot of people did not like his policies because he started upending everything. A lot of the services that they used to give, like social services, for those like 30 and younger were completely wiped out. They focused mostly on the elderly, which is fine because Japan is an aging country. For those who know anything about sociology and Japan's current state, it is an aging country. They don't have a whole lot of children. Not many families are being started there. But if you're a young person in Japan, you're 25 years old, you go to work and you're like, well, what am I doing here anymore? I'm not getting any benefits from the government. It's all going to somebody who's probably going to pass away in 5 years. So from that standpoint, a lot of stuff was going on. And Pokemon came out at a time when all this happening. And you know, it was literally months and months after the earthquakes and all this stuff. So some things were starting to settle down. So it was like that prime real estate for it to be like, here's something new for you to jump into. Here's a brand new world with these cool little pocket monsters that you can collect so you don't have to worry about the real life tragedies. And in a sick, twisted sense, that kind of makes sense then. Knowing that all this is going on, knowing that dystopian is really popular during times of tragedy or during times of like social upheaval, Pokemon monsters may have been made out of like a bomb or something. That's kind of creepy, but it kind of makes sense.
I mean, X talks about like this massive war that just happened. Mm-hmm. So
I was about to say, like, Mewtwo came from that little, I can't know what it's called, like a chateau or something.
Do you remember where Mewtwo came from?
The mansion. You go into this mansion that's completely devastated. You can only pick up bits and pieces of what happened. There's no one in there. There's like a bunch of Voltorb that keep making me think they're Pokeballs, but like, and then just you have that Mewtwo. Mewtwo's destroyed place, and you also have what happened in the Ghost Tower with Marowak and Team Rocket, that sort of thing too.
And as you move forward, both in the anime series as well as the game, you notice that the towns are slowly starting to transform themselves into cities. So there's a lot of little towns, but then as you go forward, you get to the cities, you kind of think, well, maybe this is humanity trying to rebuild itself. You know, nature's kind of come back. Now that we've claimed some of this space, we can actually start building up and improving our technology, which kind of goes with the dystopian theory. Yes?
So what about, like, when they include, like, the gym leader, Lieutenant Surge's backstory that he's an American who fought in a war?
Ooh, that just twists the knife further, doesn't it? Pokemons were made out of bombs, oh my goodness.
I had heard a while ago about a theory that before the games had been released, there had been, quote, a war within that world, and that's why there were so many, like, you don't see that many men, you only see, like, children, and you even don't even see Ash's dad, which leads you to believe. And then talking about Lieutenant Surge, and saying, oh yeah, I was in the war, blah, blah, blah. Do you know any more about that? I've heard that theory, and I don't remember.
Yeah, that's one of the theories that I read over, and I don't know how true that is. It could be, because they don't say a whole lot about the Pokemon backstory. Like, they sprinkle little bits, and we hope we can kind of figure it out. Maybe they're just trying to, like, make it interesting for the adults and let the kids gloss over it. But that was one of the theories that I did remember reading. I don't know how legitimate that it actually is. But I forgot about Ash's dad. Ash doesn't have a dad.
There's actually a reason for that behind the scenes.
Yeah, I was about to say, it's a Steven Spielberg thing.
Not really a reason. That was more of a case of one of the writers having an idea for that, but being forced to leave, so it never got pulled through. But I was going to say, there is one theme in Pokemon, like in Johto, like you have two places that burned down and or was covered by volcanic ash.
Mm-hmm.
So there is a theme of like nature sort of riling up every now and then. It was definitely, like it was definitely a big thing, big enough thing in the Ruby and Sapphire games. And sort of kind of Sinnoh, but Sinnoh was more of mind trip, let's drag this child through trippy hell, go for it, goodbye.
Congratulations.
All I can think is Shinji getting the robot. Mind trip. Did you have your hand up? Yes, you.
I was just going to say the Pokemon musical has a theory about Ash's dad.
That was fun.
I love the Pokemon musical.
That one's all kinds of special.
Like, that one's on YouTube. Watch it.
And then the last one that I'm going to cover is the auteur theory. Now, Satoshi, he's really only focused on Pokemon. I mean, that's been his bread and butter, that is his baby and his baby alone. He's been with Nintendo for a while, but he's also worked on Legend of Zelda as well as the Yoshi video games. And if you look at those games in comparison to Pokemon, you can definitely see where his influence has kind of taken place with the way the worlds are set up, with how towns are set up, even just with the animation itself. So it's very much reminiscent of his style, as well as pulling in little bits and pieces here and there. Another thing that I like is the fact that he grew up watching kaiju movies, as well as like mechas, and water pocket monsters, but little kaijus. They're awesome that way. And he's also a big fan of Studio Ghibli. So for him, nature is a key core component of what Pokemon is about. So yeah, there's Pokemon in a nutshell and all the cool things about it. So that's all I actually have on this panel. Here's some additional reading that I strongly recommend if you guys are interested in learning more about anime from a scholastic and academic viewpoint. Write these down, or you can take one of my business cards. I'll be more than happy to give you all these books. These are the ones that I recommend. The first one's from Susan J. Napier. She's actually a professor at UT in Austin, and this is a really good primer guide to anything and everything you want to know about academic anime. Probably the best one of all of these is going to be The Anime Machine. It was released last year, I believe. Very heavy, high-level reading stuff. I'm not going to deny that. That's going to probably make your brain hurt. You'll probably watch like read three pages and like, okay, I need to put this down. But it's got so much great content that it's like, this will get you an A on your book report. So we have actually a little bit of extra time. Yay, because we started early. Does anybody have any questions, anything they want to add? Yes?
So I noticed most animes, or many animes, are all set in high schools. What is their obsession with high schoolers?
High school, I can kind of answer that. High school is sort of their sort of college, first level of college. Like, you have to study to get into high school. It's up to certain.
Thank you for coming for all the people who are meeting, by the way.
It also can instruct you what sort of job you may get. Like, high school is much more serious over there than it is over here. So that's more of a culture, because high school is basically where they see you growing up as opposed to maybe going to college.
Yeah, the growing up aspect in particular for metamorphosis, that's literally the time where you become from a kid to an adult. And high school is that time where you make that transition. So many of the stories will focus on that area because of it.
If I can add to that real quick.
Yeah.
I heard from like a story design point, it's more of the fact that like the way the characters are, they roll with the punches a lot easier, and they feel like it's more of an interesting design choice.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you're a teenager at that time, you're free, you're able to do what you want. As an adult in Japan, not so much, so they find that a little bit more boring, and they feel like the characters can't go through story arcs as much as teenagers can.
A lot of that can actually be attributed to nationalism and the way the Japanese mindset is with their culture. For them, it's like, okay, you grow up to work for the country. It's not about benefiting you, it's about benefiting your country. So that makes actually perfect sense, because it's like, okay, as a kid, you can do whatever you want, doesn't matter. Once you hit adulthood, then it's like, all right, how are you going to benefit Japan? behind you, yes. Yes. Absolutely.
Dry gun too, now that I think about it.
And then the second one is like how he was talking about earlier how what was the obsession, or he was saying what was the anime obsession
with high school.
It's because, like, I guess they try to appeal to more or less of an audience that's growing up in that age setting. So they appeal to them and they feel like that they're going through the same things on certain parts of what's happening in the anime.
And I think it's interesting is that in Japan, anime is so much a part of their normal everyday culture that it doesn't matter if you're 8 or if you're 80. You're probably reading a manga or you're probably watching an anime. So it kind of crosses all barriers. Now, here in the West, though, I would say they're definitely tailoring it to Western taste. Like, for high school dramas, you're probably not going to get, like, higher than, like, a 25-year-old girl watching those things. So I think it's more tailored towards Western taste, less about Eastern taste.
Since you mentioned earlier about genres, where would you factor like hentai and primarily?
It's full art.
Do you count those as anime? And in that way, what things do they fit if you want to add a discussion?
Yeah, that one is really tricky because I can waffle on those, me personally. I've seen some scholars, like Napier, actually considers it its completely separate genre that should be studied onto its own. But then there's other scholars that I've talked to where it's like, no, it's a part of anime, but we can do like subgenres of it. So for me personally, I would say anime, like hentai and, you know, ecchi and all that would be its own separate branch. And then it just kind of intermingles with all the other stuff. Because a lot of it talks about metamorphosis. Definitely metamorphosis, not just physically, but mentally as well. And changing of the body from, you know, young girl to an adult, things like that. So, yeah, exactly. And some of them are shoujo. Some of the girls are cute, which is weird.
Infantilization.
But, you know, that's the tentacle monsters want the cute ones.
Who is a good slime bee?
Creepy shirt. Yeah.
Since you mentioned a lot of nationalistic themes, there seems to be like a great example like the assassination ashram, and the reason why it's so successful in Japan right now as opposed to the West, it seems to be like it's almost revolting against the idea because the students are not necessarily fighting for the state, the students are confident, and want to fight for themselves. Is this something that is starting to change the tide of how Japanese citizens feel about the government and what kind of media they like to consume nowadays?
I would say definitely. We're starting to see a very slow change. It's not going to happen overnight. It's going to be slow and progressive. But I think we're definitely seeing that change, especially as more of our culture is starting to permeate into their daily lives. I think the advent of the internet in particular makes it much more apparent. So you're 100% on point with that. I don't think it's going to be like 5 years from now we'll see like drastic change and children and students uprising and like saying, no, we don't want to do this. Maybe decades down the road. And I think some of that may also have to do with the fact that it's a country that is very focused on their age right now because there's so few children being born that maybe more of them are starting to realize their worth and their importance and that they need to overpower the authority because of it.
Sorry,
No, that's fine. I like interaction. I like it when people talk. I don't like to be the only talking head.
Like, what would you say about the anime that are clearly satire or deconstruction? Like, in terms of satire, the best example I can think of, and probably the only example that I know, is Assassination Classroom, which tackles the whole you can only excel mindset rather than just pass, because Japanese students have this issue of constantly being pressured to make high grades, and there is the issue of death by overwork, which is a big thing in Japan.
Sure.
They have a word for it. And Danganronpa, for example, is a very good example of tackling different issues with the culture and with the society and stuff like that. I mean, you wouldn't think so, but if you just look at it, it's basically all about tearing down stereotypes and deconstructing ideas and
this like deconstructions, like also Ava,
yeah,
too. And just how would you segment the deconstructions and the satire ones?
I would actually put those into their own separate category, but a lot of those stories also have to deal like around metamorphosis as well. Because a lot of them is about the students changing and growing and realizing where their errors are and how to become better people from it. So I think it needs its own classification, but that it can easily intermingle with a lot of the other things I've already talked about beforehand. Deconstruction is a really big thing in film theory. Oh my goodness, there's like books upon books upon books about this stuff. So I'm not surprised in the least bit that that's permeated over to Japan. But it definitely needs its own classification, but it can easily work so well with all the other theories.
Do you have any specific theories about why in America we are in the minority and animation is seen as something just for kids, like quote-unquote normal people think that it's just for kids? And
probably got to do with Disney.
I think it's a lot of it is
Disney's fault. When film initially came out here in the States, it really was just thought of to be like a throwaway thing. No one thought that this would be a lasting industry. They actually thought that this was just going to be, you know, make a couple bucks, we're done and done. That's how Nickelodeon's actually started. Do you guys know what Nickelodeon is? Not the TV station.
Yep. It was like a theater. You walked in, you paid a nickel.
Yeah. It was a small theater. You walked in, you paid a nickel. You saw like a 5-10 minute show, if that. Some of them actually had these cool little boxes that were maybe about my height, and there was a little viewfinder. You stick your nickel into the slot, you watch a 2-minute film, and you're done. And so because of that, people never really put any emphasis on film until like the 1930s, 1940s, when they realized that this could have a lasting influence. So a lot of the earlier stuff that we have is completely gone. And that breaks my heart, because like there's probably some really cool things from like the early 1900s that just do not exist because people threw it away. Animation has always been kind of seen as the same thing. People thought that it was just a throwaway item. That's why some of the first edition comic books are so difficult to get, because nobody thought they would be worth squat. So they chucked them.
Yeah, some comics were just propaganda.
Yeah, some of it was propaganda, but some of those are worth the most amount of money because they're so rare. They're impossible to get. So, I mean, and that's part of the reason why, because here we didn't really cherish our entertainment when it initially came out. And it's like that with theater, it's like that with books. I mean, you name any type of genre out there of entertainment, we didn't really appreciate it until we realized that this could last. There's something that to it. And when Disney jumped in and really took over, we looked to them as the ideal, like, okay, this is what animation's gonna be like. And unfortunately, that became our downfall at the same time, because then it was like, oh, this is just for kids. Only the kids love this stuff. They never really realized that, oh, this could be for adults too. Now, again, because manga played such a huge factor in daily Japanese life before film came there, it was easier for them to absorb it into their culture, and all was gravy. Here, I think the most adult thing we have is like Family Guy and The Simpsons. Which I appreciate.
That's not really Futurama
is
so much
great.
As sort of
I like
adult
that.
Child.
Yeah, it's one of those things where it's like
juvenile humor.
It's all comedy.
Nothing story driven.
There is nothing story driven. All the story driven stuff, like my favorite series of all time, is called Invasion America. It only came out in 1997. It was one season long. It was like 13 episodes. Of course, I have all of them, and. That's like the only adult animation I have seen, and that was meant more for like the teenage group, because it actually had drama and a storyline. It was like, oh crap, this is not meant to be funny, but it didn't last. This is unfortunately not the market for it. However, with the popularity of the nerd genre, as nerds are starting to grow up and start ruling the world, we're starting to see comic books and all that culture taking over.
Big Bang Theory.
You can especially see it in some cartoons like Avatar, and especially Steven Universe.
Avatar, yeah, Avatar has definitely made a big difference in getting adults back into animation, especially from the Western standpoint. Not the crappy movie.
The last year?
What movie?
We don't talk about that movie.
What movie? They made a movie.
Didn't happen.
Hang on, guys. Sorry.
I read stuff about how like. Manga is pretty much for everyone. There are genres and companies that produce manga for every type of person. And so it's well accepted. So society.
Yes.
And I've also read that on the flip side, anime isn't actually necessarily considered for all ages, even though there is animation, you know, for all ages, apparently. Mm-hmm. But not as widely accepted. And was wondering why that was. It's like if you read manga, you're just a normal person, but if you like watch anime, then suddenly you're like the, you know, the dread
of
otaku within Japanese society.
Actually, you pinpointed on it. It's because of the rise of the fan culture and the otakus that's the reason people are starting to look at anime like, what is this weirdness going on? Now, most people are still pretty cool with anime in Japan, but you do have that subset that's like, no, it's just for the weirdos, it's just for the kids, because they go super crazy about it. And here and there, you know how here we have like certain time slots when certain things are acceptable for people to watch, like, you know, 8 a.m. to 12 p.m. is for, like, all the kids stuff, then 12 to 2 is like trashy soap operas and so on and so forth. They have that kind of thing there in Japan too. So you'll see more of the adult stuff like late at night. And I know that people are watching it. They wouldn't keep spending so much money and producing half their content on animes if people weren't watching it. Because definitely Japan is profiting from it, not from moving it over here and selling, but from their own citizens watching it. But it is that rise of the otaku and the fan clubs that make people go, I don't want to be involved with these people.
I was about to add, it is basically an issue because so many studios face bankruptcy if they don't cater to the otaku.
Ghibli?
Not Ghibli. Ouch. Ghibli has like everything. I was talking more like Studio Simples. Bones,
yeah.
Gainax, maybe. If you don't, like, the otaku is pretty much where the money is. Like, the studio KyoAni, Kyoto Animation, faces so much success because it targets that particular point. And a lot of companies, if they try to branch out too much, they end up bombing big time and losing so much money that they go out of business. So oftentimes, some companies have just been losing money over time because they try to branch out too much or don't budget themselves properly. Gynax is a very good example of not budgeting yourself properly.
So I have one more because we're about to run out of time. Did you want to add in something?
Sure. I guess this was kind of a tail on to my previous question.
Sure.
So in like the 1980s, there's that string of murders, like the talking murderers.
Yes.
How did that, it obviously really negatively impacted, so talking stuff going on, but how did it actually affect like media that was produced during the time? Because 1980s, 1990s.
You know what, there is actually currently a study, and I should have gone not forward it so quickly. Ian Condrey is actually working on a study right now, and he's writing a paper about that. I'm curious to read it, so I'm waiting for him on that one. So look up Ian Condrey and wait for his words, because I would like to see what the relationship is. Because I think that's something we've all been kind of working on, but he's actually jumping in and doing it. He's actually going out and getting interviews with people's families who actually were involved in it. So keep an eye on Ian Condrey, and that'll help answer your question. All right, cool. So my time is up. Thank you guys for both of you who stuck around. I really, really appreciate it. Enjoy the rest of your convention. I hope you learned something. And tell your parents and your teachers, Pokemon's for adults too.